So we talked about insulin resistance and prediabetes, diabetes, population-wide, the number one cause of this problem. You quoted that CDC number of a third of us. The reality is JAMA has done some studies. UCLA has done some studies over the past couple of years that would indicate it's actually over half of us 30 years and older. We all know that it increases. Obesity, yes, is a major driver, but age is an even bigger driver. So if we're in our 50s and 60s, we really need to be afraid. We need to be very afraid. Make sure that we know exactly what our glucose metabolism, our carbohydrate metabolism is. And most of us don't know it.
The problem is that I think that hopefully you'll agree with me. I think medicine's gotten very sloppy because, you know, we don't do a simple glucose tolerance test anymore. Right? Get to come in fasting, see what your blood sugar is, drink the sweet drink, and check your blood sugar at 1 and 2 hours and see how you're handling the sugar load. Doctors, they'll do a fasting blood sugar, they'll do a A1C, which is a great test for following diabetics, but it's a lousy test for diagnosing insulin resistance, right? And so instead of doing that, they'll just do the simple one blood stick thing and tell you you're fine. And they're missing a lot of 60% or more of the people with insulin resistance by doing that.
Even the endocrinologists have said, you know what? A1C is not a good way to diagnose it. Anything that impacts hemoglobin is going to impact A1C. Things like pregnancy, genetics, you know, depending on which part of the world you're coming from and which genetic pool you're coming from. Kidney disease, liver disease, all these things can impact hemoglobin. And when they do, they impact A1C. So yeah, you're right. In fact, I actually learned doing OGTTs on people for this purpose from Brad and Amy. I've gone a little bit farther and I do what's called a Kraft insulin survey. So instead of just looking at our body's moving reaction to a glucose challenge for how much your glucose is changing in your blood, I also look at how much insulin is being required to manage your blood glucose. Very, very interesting thing. What I'll find is about 20% of folks where I would have scratched my head in the past and said, you know, you've got plaque, you don't have other causes, you clearly look like you've got some insulin resistance, but your numbers are not really that bad. Well, then I'll go back and find that it's taking twice, three, 10, 12 times the amount of insulin that it should to manage their glucose. So it adds a significant amount to just start looking at insulin as well.
And so I've just, you know, Barb and I have been doing this for about 4 years now, and I'm just starting to sort of say, yeah, maybe I should be looking at the HOMA-IR too. So I've been doing that a lot more because, you know, there's a lot of people that it doesn't show up on their fasting blood sugar, or their, you know, their routine fasting blood sugar and stuff. So I'm doing insulins and HOMA-IRs on people more frequently now too.
To me, HOMA-IR has been fairly deceptive, again, because most of the HOMA-IR values that I've seen are a static value. And it's sort of like, you know, getting a static picture is sort of like getting a picture of me standing out smiling in the street, but we don't know that a bus is getting ready to run over me. So very similar analogy. We have to watch, as you mentioned earlier, a challenge. How does our body manage that challenge? You know, speaking of challenges in life, I gave you a little challenge early on about recovered cardiologists. You smiled and have already mentioned you like that analogy. I think you've covered it pretty well already, that your typical cardiologist has a very different perspective on what we're doing. The typical cardiologist is busy doing a lot of other stuff and sometimes doesn't have the time to focus on the root cause, you know, has other stuff on his or her plate.